And we welcome you inside the Buford City Arena in Buford, Georgia, where it's game 2 of 4 for the GHSA state semifinals. And as you see on the screen, wow, do we have a good one. It's the 22-8 Norcross Blue Devils facing the top team in all of the United States of America, the 30-0 McEachern Indians. And hey there, everybody. Thanks for joining us with the Kennesaw State legend and national champion, Terrence Hill. I am Justin Hanover. And I've been waiting for this game for the past week, Terrence. We've got two teams that know each other very well. Last year, Norcross won by 20 in the quarterfinals against McEachern. They just weren't ready to win it all. This year, though, McEachern's got a shot to do some special things. First, though, to the visitors in Norcross and a superstar themselves in Brandon Boston.
Yeah, this kid reminds me of a younger version of Brandon Ingram, a taller guard with a long first step. So what that does is it creates a better shot for him. And with the extension of his arms, he can get to the basket and makes it harder for the defender to stop him.
So Norcross with a five-star superstar of their own. Meanwhile, Sharif Cooper, he's a five-star, and he's as good as they come.
He is, and he's quite the opposite of Brandon Boston. Sharif is a smaller guard, but he makes up for it with his passing ability and his scoring ability. He's able to get inside, shift gears a little bit, and he can shield his body from the taller defenders and can score the basket.
So both superstars, they also have some other great players, Kyle Sturdivant and Isaac Okoro. Let's look at some of the keys here to this matchup.
That would be to limit Cooper's looks. Don't let him get any clean looks. So that means driving him off the arc, get him inside. Once he gets inside, everyone collapse. This is going to be a team effort. And, of course, controlling the glass. Every possession, you secure the basketball before you leak out, and that's how you'll win if you're Norcross. McEachern. It's Cooper and Okor. Those two will propel you to a win tonight, and also dominating with the press. This is what you do. Press. This is what got you here. Continue to press full court, half court press, see if you can get some steals.
Coach Thompson's team, so much has his team with that ferocious defense. Let's go down to the PA announcer for the starting lineups. Season with the school only went 16-13. Coach McMillan's best record, or worst record, I should say, is 24-9 overall, 275-67. You just got a good look at Coach Thompson. Absolutely phenomenal what he's done. But Terrence, they have got to win a state championship. The numbers are incredible. McEachern must win it all.
It is. You have all the accolades. You have everything as a coach. Sometimes it's that one thing that separates you from being the number one coach in the state, and it's that championship. So he wants to try to secure that tonight, try to move to the finals, but that's definitely one thing that's separating him from being the number one coach.
The Indians in white, the Blue Devils in blue. Jump ball won by Norcross. That's Issa Muhammad, a top college prospect, wins the jump, 12.6 rebounds, four blocks a couple of games ago against Grayson. Here we go. Norcross with the first possession. Devon Eskridge wearing number 20 tonight, a change from what he had in the past at 25. Rebound out of bounds. We'll stay right here.
You know, I like what they did on the first possession. They came out, had a wheel in the middle of the paint, threw it to the big man, Muhammad. He wasn't able to score the ball, but I like what they're doing. Try to start inside. He gets the big basket there. Start inside and work your way out.
A set play off the inbounds. And wow, Issa Muhammad puts it down. Your officials tonight, John Ewalt, Doug Richardson, and Marvin Harris. So 2-0 Norcross with that first bucket on the slam. Here's Isaac Okoro, the Reger Player of the Year. Jared Jones, the big fella, no good, tries to tip it. A little hot potato will stay right here off of Muhammad, much to his chagrin, as it hit the senior last.
You know, coming out in these games, at the beginning you'll see a lot of nerves with players, maybe missing a couple shots. But as the game goes on, players start to heat up, and they'll start fine-tuning the mistakes that they made in the first half.
Sharif Cooper, so amazing. And who will win this game? Let us know. Is McElroy on fire early on with that three? It's prediction time in the Facebook comment section. Let us know who you think will win today's game. It's certainly one of those 50-50 type affairs. As Brandon Boston says, we're going to win this game.
Norcross, they come out and they notice the 1-2 zone full court press that McEachern was in. And one thing with that zone is you find yourself susceptible to open shots. And Brandon Boston found himself for an open three in the corner.
Muhammad with some hops up there, grabbing that rebound. So Okoro on the miss. Three-pointer up, rattles out. Cooper looks for the fast break. Lineal Moon thinks Norcross is going to come away with it and end that perfect season for McEachern at 30-0. Renee says McEachern, of course. I heard a lot of those doing it with Chris Moodyham the last 3 weeks in the wins over East Coweta, Cherokee, and Petrie Ridge. A lot of Indian fans out there.
I'm so impressed right now. And I know it's still early, but both teams are sticking with their game plan. As you see, Norcross get really methodical with the passing it around the zone before they make a shot.
The travel called on Boston. You see Brandon there looking at potentially Duke, Kentucky. He's a five-star. He's as good as they come. Just had an unofficial visit to Kentucky. In that round of 16 against Grayson, went for 20-11 and four blocks. Okoro, great interior pass, and Jones can't finish. That's a good job by the big fella passing it down low, but the former Pebblebrook Falcon couldn't get it to go. But look who did, as Caleb Murphy extends the lead now to four.
You know, that's just a great navigation. Being able to push the ball up the court, navigate, go to your right, get the crossover, absorb the contact, and still finish the basket. But with McEachern, if you can zone in, I really appreciate their jerseys. On the back, it says, yes, we are greater than me. And this stands for something. This is a mantra that you need. It stands that, you know, collectively, we can win, and this is what we stand for.
Well, they got to stick together here because they're in territory they haven't been in a long time. They have not been trailing except for a 3-2 deficit in that last game against Petrie Ridge all playoffs. Literally for a couple of seconds in every single playoff game, that's been it. So now they're down 8-3. Little early adversity for Coach Thompson's squad. And a turnover, 5 seconds.
You know, you have that adversity, but with a team and a player as Cooper, you're lucky and you have that luxury of having a player like him. Because just as quick as you face the adversity, he's able to calm the team down, yes, get them settled, and get back in the game.
Certainly the junior is a leader. He got a good shot of Coach McMillan on the Norcross sidelines, 275 and 67 overall. They've been to the championship game each of the last 2 years, but fell short as Muhammad gets it stripped away by McElroy. Here comes Okoro giving up. Sharif Cooper goes right. And we mentioned before we even went on the broadcast, Sharif Cooper, he's almost ambidextrous. Yeah. You don't know if he's going left. You don't know if he's going right. You can't overplay him. And he went right that time.
He did. And he just fills the lane so well. He's smaller, so it's hard to find him sometimes. But even when you do see him finally, by that time, he's already at the basket scoring the ball.
Tried to give it off, but caught in the air, stolen away. Kyle Sturdivant goes up left, rattles it in. And a five-point advantage again at 10-5. Allen Green bringing it up. Excellent shooter. Was great drive in the lane in that 83-51 win against Cherokee with Breed, but he's certainly known for that shooting from the outside. Speaking of shooting from the outside, no good, and cleared by Boston.
And as you see, Boston, he's only taken one shot so far, and he's allowed his other teammates to get involved. But this is a leadership that you have to see, and a lot of times at the high school level, you don't see it. Let your teammates get involved, because in a quickness, he can turn his game on at any point.
You see that a lot from LeBron. LeBron, absolutely, back in the day would do that. As Jared Jones tips it to himself, would conscientiously want to get those teammates involved. Here's Breed, drives to the lane, and Allen Breed will head to the line for a pair.
And as you see, the drive, as we take a look at the replay, it's just Cooper just playing with aggression, trying to get to the hole. But this is a guy that's going to attack all day. He gets the ball, he's going to attack. Why stop? Take it to the hole, force them to foul you. If not, let's see if we can score the basket and get down to play some defense.
First free throw by Breed, no good. Allen Breed, 18 against East Coweta in that first round. 6'3" junior, averages right around 11 or so per game. You know about the superstars in Okoro, who's going to Auburn. You know about Cooper, obviously, who had Coach Cal in Powder Springs last week looking at him. But it's some of these other guys. Jared Jones, who transferred from Pebblebrook. He's a beast down low. Allen Breed can shoot the lights out. Quinton McElroy was phenomenal in that last game. Can shoot with the best of them. As that ball rattles out, Daniel Ramsey, the big 6'8" senior. Okoro, oh, baby! Oh, they're going to call a foul on Boston. It got so loud momentarily, I didn't even hear the whistle.
You know, that was great two possessions. On one end, you have Jones coming up with the defensive stop, meeting the guy at the rim, going in transition, and then you find Okoro baiting the defender in right at the right moment, hits him with the Euro step. He finds himself at the free throw line shooting too.
Isaac Okoro, known as a phenomenal defender, maybe the best in the country. He at least thinks he is, and he's got a case. And meanwhile, he averages 22 points and 9 rebounds on the offensive end. I guess there's a reason why Sharif Cooper, who's got a shot to win not only the Georgia Player of the Year, but could win the National Player of the Year, but yet he didn't even win the Region Player of the Year because of this man at the foul line.
And you got to take that and say, you know what, that just means that you have some players that's dedicated to win, and you have high-caliber players on your team. And if you want to win a state championship, you're going to need that, because a lot of times, not only one player is going to beat you and win a state championship.
He's Terrence Hill. I'm Justin Hanover. Appreciate you joining us here on the NFHS Network and Facebook. We'll be with you for the championships next week as well from Macon. The nightcap will be on next Saturday at 7 o'clock. The winner of this game, as Boston puts it up, looks for his rebound, fighting hard. Brandon Boston. Oh, that's going to be a goaltend on Jared Jones. And it's back up to a four-point lead. The winner of this game at 7 o'clock next Saturday will play the winner of this evening. And that's obviously another very good one, with Meadow Creek, the defending champions, against the 2017 champions in Tift County. Breed. That's in and out. Pulled down well by Caleb Murphy, the junior, who's a mid-major recruit. Look at Caleb Murphy. Swings it across. Put up. That's missed by Ramsey.
I tell you, both teams, man, I know they're familiar with the court size, but you see a lot of times with Norcross and McEachern, both teams are starting their offense far from the three-point line because they want a little bit more space to operate.
Cooper from Okoro puts it up and in, this time with the left hand. Again, Isaac Okoro can do it all, from scoring to blocking to assisting. And there's Cooper with momentum, putting it up and in, lead down to two.
You know, you have to appreciate players like Cooper. Not only does he play on the offensive end, he scores, and then he comes back and plays defense in almost 4 to 5 seconds. So you have to appreciate players like Cooper.
Coach Thompson's defense, absolutely incredible. How they can turn you over in a hurry. They did it the last 3 weeks in the playoffs and gave no shot whatsoever to either of those three opponents. Sturdivant. And Cooper did just enough for that to Rim out. Here's Breed. Back to Sharif. Okoro drives the lane with power, and it's stolen away. Good job by Daniel Ramsey. Here comes Boston, and Cooper's going to pick up a foul. He didn't want him to break. Now, Sharif last week had four early on. It didn't really matter because they were in control for the most part against Peachtree Ridge. But this could be the one thing that can really do them in, because this is not the deepest of teams, McEachern.
Yeah, and the thing is, with the team, when you're facing a team like Norcross, you're going to have to go to your bench. You're going to have to rely to them at some point. So we're going to see how that plays out, because right now, this is an up and down pace. So players are going to find themselves tired. They're going to have to go to the bench more.
Oh, Sharif caught it, took a little hop, and he said no to the official. 55 seconds to go, 12-10. Blue Devils on top. I think Sharif gets away with that half the time, probably. That's why he's frustrated.
You know, the first time that I saw, had a chance to see, and I know I was late to the party. First time I had a chance to see Cooper was when he was in the corner and he hit the James Harden step back. And ever since then, I've been following this young man. He has a great game. And yeah, to get the stamp and approval from KD, I think it speaks volumes.
Yeah, Sharif had some moves. In these. Oh, that's an extra step for sure on Ramsey. Sharif had a couple of moves over these past few weeks that if there was a Heisman moment or a Georgia Gatorade Player of the Year moment, he had a couple of them. Going through three guys, going between his legs, behind the back. Just, he's an incredible player, an incredible young man.
You know, and we marvel at that, but that's just another day in the office for him.
Yes.
He's that type of player.
And he's only a junior. It's scary. This team can run the table this year, theoretically. Bring Sharif back. They'll lose Okoro, but bring almost everybody else back and run the table again. Final 13 seconds, and they look to hold for one. A three-pointer can give them the lead. Only lead was at 2-0. Cooper picks up his dribble, swings it across. Breed is going to take that. Three ball for the lead. No good. Ramsey clears, and that should do it. So 8 minutes in the books. A good first quarter for Norcross. They'll take a 12-10 lead to the break on the NFHS Network. Right, very good.
NFHS Learning Center is the leader in online education for the interscholastic community. At nfhslearn.com, you can find over 60 courses for coaches, administrators, officials, parents, students, and performing arts programs, including over 25 free courses such as concussion in sports, heat illness prevention, sudden cardiac arrest, and protecting students from abuse. For more information, visit the NFHS Learning Center.
Back here in Buford, 2-point lead for the Blue Devils. They've led pretty much throughout, save 2-0. Here's Sharif Cooper and the top-ranked team in the nation. Appreciate you joining us here on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch. He's Terrence Hill. I'm Justin Hanover. Good first quarter for the Blue Devils. They hung around the number one team in the nation for sure.
And I tell you, there's different points of the game where it's pivotal. And coming out of that first quarter, going into the second.
Oh, look at Jared Jones knocking it down.
And I was mentioning that. You need a great play coming out of that first quarter. And McEachern was able to execute that and find himself with a three.
Boston throws it all the way across. Oh, and what a big time move. Brandon Boston puts it up in, almost a little finger roll-like. They regain the lead. Sharif Cooper trailing by one. Really a game you expect to come down to the wire. We're not going to see a 20-point blowout like last year in the quarters, that's for sure. And the aggressive move, Jared Jones with a foul.
And as Jones goes up for that block, one thing that you have to know for all players, you need to know the personnel of the referees. How are they calling a game? This is a skill. You need to know how they're calling it, if you're able to go up and get that block, or if you need to pull back just a little bit. Jones goes up for the block, finds himself with another foul.
So here's Murphy at the line, the junior. 13-5 Caleb Murphy against Grayson. 6 of 12 points in the fourth quarter against Roswell. 6'3" junior guard. Real experienced team is Norcross. A lot of guys that have been there and done that. And it's a 15-13 Blue Devil advantage. Dexter Hubbard, nothing like Georgia sports. I'm in, Dexter. As good as they come. Football, basketball, you name it. Post up, that opens it up for Jones. Can he hit another one? The big fella knocking him down.
Look at that.
Jones is in his bag right now, and he's going to stay in that same spot until Norcross push him off. He's going to stay at the top of the key because that's his spot. But nowadays, you have that five man that can pull up and knock that three down.
Lots of star power. Well said, Jacob. Oh, the tipping. How good is that by Muhammad? Issa Muhammad's come to play. Let's take a look at what these guys run defensively now. Norcross, primarily man-to-man. They'll do a little 1-3-1, a little 2-2-1 press. You don't really see a lot of press right now. It seems like they're laying back. They don't want to get beat and let McEachern go on one of those patented type runs.
You know what? What pulled them out of that full court press? The first time and first opportunity that they did it was in the first quarter, and they got beat, and then they found Brandon Boston in the corner for a three. Since then, they have not went to the full court press.
Here's Okoro, 6 minutes to go in the second quarter. 17-16 Blue Devils. Jared Jones with a couple of three-pointers. Rebounded there by Boston. Sturdivant kicks it out. Three-ball corner, no good. All over the boards is Issa Muhammad. No good. And Jones clears.
It's a great rebound from the big guy, Muhammad. You find Muhammad on the defensive end. Land off with Jones because he wants to protect the rim. He's a great defender. But what happens is Jones is going to pop out like he just did his possession. Luckily, they didn't find him, but he is really going to hurt them if he continues to leave him open at the top of the key.
Okoro across McElroy. He can certainly hit a three. All these guys can hit threes. Jones. Three ball. Oh, well short. And that's trouble. Jared Bush checks in, misses that. Boston triple. No good. And Jones doing it all, gets up, gives it off to Cooper as we dip under the five-minute mark. Here's Sharif. Cooper, little one-on-one.
You know, Norcross is going to sit back. As we're going to talk about, they're going to sit back and allow them to shoot.
Now, a timeout there from Coach Thompson. It looked like a little bit of frustration for the coach and from Sharif Cooper. What exactly, what are they going to discuss? Why did he take the timeout right there? Is it a lack of inside play?
The reason I think he called that timeout was you want to be able to, like, go to your game plan. And at that point, I don't think he saw too much movement with the ball. Didn't see any plays been executed. So he wanted to call a quick timeout, talk to the players to see if they can run something and get the offense a little bit, coming to you a little bit more easier than what it has so far.
Where are you watching from? In the Facebook comment section, let us know where you're watching from. Anybody outside the country, maybe we'll give you a shout out. First couple of viewers during the broadcast. You look at some of these guys on McEachern, the starting five, 55-3 the last 2 years. Okoro and Cooper a combined 84-4 together wearing a McEachern uniform. Now Okoro's going to Auburn, we know that. He's going to try and take his buddy Cooper with him. But Coach Calipari from Kentucky was in Powder Springs last week at that Peachtree Ridge game, and it could be a fight between a couple of SEC powers.
Yeah, it's going to be something else to see if they do go. Regardless what team they go to, it's just going to be whatever team they get or go to, they're going to have an exceptional player in both players, man, because they bring it every single possession.
And they'll reset here with 4:20 to go, 17-16. Blue Devils in the lead. They needed to limit Cooper's ability to get clean looks off the pick and roll. They've done a nice job. Sharif, a couple of buckets in low as Jones looks for the third three, it looked like. Not able to go. They needed to limit Okoro's touches in the paint. They've done a nice job with that. Norcross's defense has really done well.
Yeah, and they stepped up to the challenge. It's a lot of film watching. Knowing what you need to do. They've done a great job so far as they allow Muhammad to get 2 points inside. But so far, they've done a stellar job with preventing Okoro to get inside and hurt.
Issa Muhammad You can tell from warm-ups how pumped he was for this. Here's Okoro, down three, kicks it out. Allen Breed, long three-pointer, front rim. Okoro, oh, and what a fight to get another possession. Sharif fakes the three, drives the lane, saves it, but Brandon Boston is going to get it. Lobs it up, Kyle Sturtevant. Just a bit high for Muhammad, but a lucky bounce goes to Jaden Harris, the sophomore.
Sturtevant just saw a smaller guy on Muhammad, so he just wanted to talk to that to him to see if he can go get it. The pass was a little too hard for Muhammad.
Brandon Boston, real good play off of Jones. One of those plays you don't see in the box score. Wins another possession the way Okoro just earned another one on the other end of the floor.
When it comes to basketball, anything, body language says a lot. And in the warm-ups, you can see McEachern. The body language is a little down. And right now, and I see a lot of guys winded right now. And let's see if that affects them going into finishing this half, and also if it affects them coming in, going into the second half.
We definitely noticed Norcross seemed to have more energy in the warm-ups. They were bouncing up and down. They had a few more smiles. McEachern seemed a little bit close to the vest, a little bit tight. So we'll see how that plays out through the end. But Norcross, certainly a good start here. Let's remember, we know all about Norcross. They've been in the last two finals. They're also a team that lost eight games this year. So they're facing a team in McEachern that's 30-0. You would think maybe Norcross would be the tight team, and McEachern would be loose and confident. So far, so good for Coach McMillan's squad.
Yeah, both teams are battle-tested, so that's not an issue. Both teams have faced high-caliber talent and opponents, but right now it just seems like they're winded on the McEachern's end. But that could also be a disguise. That could be part of the game. Yeah. They don't want to give too much in the first half.
Isaac Okoro getting a touch inside. Very sweet finish. And just like that, Indians within one. And I've seen them go on a ton of those 12-2 quick runs. Well, are they going to count that? They're calling a block. Certainly Jones hit it on the way down. McElroy called for the foul. Very interesting.
I think with McElroy, he was in position. The one thing that he did wrong was he dropped his hands and tried to brace the contact. If he would have stayed in place and absorbed the contact, that would have been an offensive foul.
Now let's take another look. Well, maybe not. They're going to call it a clean block. So Jared Jones knocking down threes, blocking shots, getting on the boards. There's Muhammad.
He has a soft touch.
Yes, he does. Issa Muhammad at 6'9". Coach McMillan said playoff basketball is about half-court offense and half-court defense. And you have to hold them, and that's what they did last week in that third quarter in the victory against Roswell. Remember, the Hornets were up 32-30 at the break. Norcross showed a lot of grit. Cooper, rebound. Muhammad corrals it in with one hand. Here comes Sturtevant. Bounce pass to Issa. Oh, a lot of contact, nothing called. And Muhammad continues to rack up the numbers in a four-point lead.
And at the last minute, Muhammad was able to slide just slightly to the right and prevent the charge. But I think, you know, in that situation, he did a great job, but you got to find a big man running down the floor more often.
Speaking about big men running down the floor, that's missed. Do you like the no calls with a lot of contact, no calls?
I think, you know, being in the semifinals, you expect this. You also got to prepare them for the collegiate play. It's going to be physical. So you want to see how they can adjust. But I do like what the referees are doing so far.
Issa Muhammad on fire. Spin move, McElroy back out. 6-point lead, half a dozen. The largest as we approach a minute to go here in the opening half. A territory these Indians have not known for a while. Three ball. Jared Jones has done it again. That's now three triples for the big fella.
Muhammad raises his hand to his coach saying, you know, coach, my bad. I should have stepped out. But again, Muhammad wants to stay inside and protect the rim. The one thing bad about that is you allow your guy to float around the three-point line. Jones done that three times. In three plays, he's knocked down a three from the same spot.
Jared, a second-team All-Region player, former Pebblebrook Falcon, and he was our player of the game last week. He did it all against Peachtree Ridge. Final 20 seconds, three-point Norcross lead. Looks like Sharif Cooper's going to want to hold for one. Kyle Sturdivant breathing a little bit heavy. And let's see if Cooper takes advantage. He does, but he can't get it to go. Here comes Brandon Boston, 10 seconds. Behind the back, Breed chasing. And a travel called with 6.7 remaining.
Yeah, he gathered his steps. He took an extra step when he tried to go into the defender. But even with Cooper on the other end, it's a matter of just the intangible sometimes. He was able to look at the defender. Once the defender looked away just for a split second, he then started his drive because it's so quick. And sometimes that's what separates great players.
Cooper is going to pick it up in midcourt with 6.7. Final possession, down three. Sharif Cooper for the tie at the break. No good. And Isaac Martin corrals it in. And a good first half for Norcross. They led pretty much throughout, save 2-0 and one other time, as Issa Muhammad all over the floor. And if you're the Blue Devils, you're excited. Quick thoughts before we go to the break.
I think both teams came out, executed the game plan well, but now it's about the adjustments. What coaching adjustments can you make coming out of the second half?
24-21 Norcross. Some video from Slam coming up here on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch.
Dykeman is like a place. You know, the atmosphere is crazy. You got to bring your game.
It's a great court, great environment. People are really into it. It's just crazy to be on such a legendary park.
When I hear Dykeman, I think of hardcore basketball. Everyone giving it they all, not caring who you are.
Dykeman, you just got to come out and play hard and show the crowd what you can do. They don't care about the mixtape. They don't care about what they see on social media. They care about what they see at the moment. So it's like you always got to bring it.
It's different from regular high school games because there's more talent. People know what they're doing. It's not going to be blood. It's going to be a good game. I'm not approaching it different. I'm still got the same mentality going into the game. I'm going to dog everybody, kill everybody, come up to him.
I was blessed just to get the invite, just to get invited down here, especially because it was my first time being in New York City.
You know, Slam is like the face of grassroots basketball.
We were really the first media brand to talk about basketball as a culture. I just want to thank every one of you guys, really, from the bottom of my heart, for coming in, making the first Slam game happen.
You know, this whole thing's going to be a celebration of you guys, basketball culture, New York City basketball culture, and all of you who are really our next generation of stars.
This is the first one, and they selected all of us to be the headliners for the first time, so it's an honor. And then being in New York, it's cool to be on a different coach and seeing different things.
Today, we went to Facebook, Instagram, headquarters.
We all got verified, got tours of Instagram and Facebook.
So who else they give the check? Everybody got the check, right?
They talk to us, we play Fortnite.
That's not supposed to happen. There's people like me who really grind out my dubs. People like Cassius can sit out the whole game and somehow just find a way to win.
I'm sitting back with the West Coast boys.
Right now we're going to do 3-point one-on-one and dunk contest at a Lifetime Gym. We're in New York. It's really different from LA.
The one-on-ones, everyone's into it. You know, we playing hard defense, wasn't letting up.
I lost in the one-on-one finals to Ramsey.
Play
dunk contest was live. Everyone brought energy. Everyone was hyped.
Guys really brought their game.
It was me, Ramsey, Andre, and Cassius, and, you know, we just came out, did our thing. And Cassius came up on top.
Man, you see how I'm coming. I'm the champ, they gotta carry my belt.
And then we're here on this boat. I have no clue what we're doing, but we're on a boat.
We out here. Is this the Hudson River?
So,
four coming. Hey, let's get our two champions of our dunk contest and our one-on-one contest up here. Here's how it's gonna work. We're gonna rock, paper, scissors. The first pick, step up to the table.
Team Stanley versus Team Ramsey.
Rock, paper, scissors, says shoot.
All right, here we go. Kansas got first pick.
My guy, Josh Goodson.
I'm a West Coast guy, so I kind of just went with most of the West Coast guys.
Our team's stacked. We got all the West Coast guys, basically. So we got to win, obviously, put on for the West Coast.
It's fun to play against these guys. Just getting to compete is always fun. Today for the game at 1, we got there, watched the girls game before us, all the top players, and they put on a show.
What's the game plan today?
We started warming up on our side court and getting dressed, and people started filing in.
Just make sure you're strong and loose before we go.
This is the energy, you know, the environment that they're playing in. So it's live, everyone's into the game.
I don't think any of us really knew what was gonna happen. We're all competitors and we just wanted to see what Dyke was really all about and make sure.
Hey man, this is crazy, huh? This is a different level, man, it's lit.
That's a place where they don't care about your name. All they care about is, you know, what they see at the moment, you playing the Dyke. So if you don't play good, the fans are gonna think you're trash. And even if you're not good on social media, you come and you kill a Dykeman, everybody at Dykeman think all of a sudden you're a superstar.
The game was like ecstatic, especially the atmosphere. Every time I got the ball, it was loud, so I had to like lock in and try to focus. It hyped me up a lot.
We playing to win, but at the same time, we playing to get our name out and have fun. But as soon as someone go at you, that's that one-on-one. That's when you gotta lock in, you gotta really show out right there. Everybody came, play hard. I was on Cash's team. We lost by like 10 or something like that.
It was my debut. It's my first time being at the Dyke in the Park, so it was a great experience.
I not only became a fan today, but New York City was impressive.
This is a great experience, a humble experience. Shout out to Slam for even having us, inviting me. Shout out to New York for, you know, having us at the Dykeman. In a couple years, it's going to blow up. So next year, I hope I'm able to come back.
I wish I was a junior so I could be here next year for the Volume 2. It was a great weekend. Did so many fun things in such a short amount of time. But shout out to Slam. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Back here at the Buford City Arena, Terrence Hill, Justin Hanover with you in one of the best matchups you will see in the entire country in the season 2019. Norcross with the three-point lead. Issa Muhammad, Brandon Boston, absolutely dominant. Let's take a look at a couple of highlights here in which they are obviously going to be involved in. The Indians 30-0, but so far, Issa Muhammad, Terrence, has been an aggressive force.
Yeah, you have to. You have to be aggressive because that's what they need from your teacher, Norcross. Take it to him. Now you see Brandon Boston getting him involved. It was a controversy call at that point, but stay getting him involved because once you put that pressure on the inside, the outside will start opening up for Brandon Boston, and continue to run the floor. If you're Muhammad, you're going to get rewarded if you run the floor.
Issa Muhammad, 9 points, 5 rebounds. We'll look the other way. Isaac Okoro swings it out to Jared Jones, who knocked down 3 threes. He had 9 points, but he was big from the outside.
Yeah, give credit to Jones because he's finding himself in the right spots. He's using his basketball IQ of getting open, and he's found his spot right now at the top of the key. He's knocked down 3 threes so far.
And Brandon Boston, who we did not even really see in the highlights, 9 points and 12 rebounds, a dozen boards in just 16 minutes.
Yeah.
You didn't even realize that's how good he is, Terrence.
And I tell you, man, it's just you really marvel at something like that. You want some guys like that that does a little bit of everything on the court.
Speaking about a little bit of everything, Kyle Sturtevant from downtown, and the lead back up to half a dozen for the Blue Devils. When asked about this matchup, Kyle Sturtevant said it's going to be a heavyweight fight, most definitely. Normally, though, Norcross is the one with the target on their chests. They're more of the hunter today. It's an odd situation for that program. They're normally the hunted.
They are. They're not used to this, being down like this. But with the players they have, I do see them being able to come back. But you have to get stops every possession, knock down some shots, and execute some plays.
Here's Cooper. Only 4 in that first half. Swings it out. McElroy didn't nail a 3 in the first half. No good. Jared Jones, and it'll stay right here.
Jim McEachern, you want to ride this wave. Coming out of the break, you want to ride this wave because you've been tired. So you have your energy now. You have your legs in. So ride this wave as long as you can until it comes down, and that's when you start going into the offensive set of the half-court set.
Sharif Cooper, we just saw him a little bit in that halftime feature from Slam. Cooper for 3, rattles out. Muhammad clears again for half a dozen boards for Issa.
And it's one of those things. How do you see the cup half empty or full for McEachern? They're only down by 6 points right now,
right.
And Cooper's not having the best of games.
And where are you watching this from? You see on the screen as Jared Jones is not watching much. Cooper's going to take it himself, and Brandon Boston tried to size it up, and that'll be a basket. Dexter, thanks for joining us from Columbus, and Lloyd Spinner out of Woodstock, Virginia. Is anybody further away than Lloyd? Let us know. Boston, baseline, swings it out.
I want to speak to Lloyd for a second. Lloyd, sometimes you just have to send a message that, you know what, regardless of the goal 10, I'm going to send a message that you're not going to get an easy basket here, and that's what Boston did the last possession.
Good defending there from Jones on Muhammad. Christian Brown, thank you, and Jamal Respan. Oh, lost ball somehow almost went in for Cooper, and Muhammad clears number 7. Here comes Sturtevant looking to run. They do like to run. Boston. That's in and out. Sturtevant, a whirling dervish, puts it up and in. And the lead again up to 6.
And it's the energy level at this point. I know McEachern's got their legs so far, but it just doesn't seem like Norcross lost any step or any bounce so far.
How good is that, though, from Isaac Okoro? The sweet little touch.
In order for a big man to be effective offensively, you need that soft touch. We saw that he has a soft touch at the three-point line, but being able to get that spin move and have that soft touch with the right hook says a lot, man. You have someone that has an arsenal offensively.
Boston spins it to Muhammad. That's short, out of bounds. You know, it has the feel in this game, as we take another look at this replay here of Boston, but the goaltend, it has the feel of Norcross really being comfortable and up big. And you look up, it's only a 4-point lead.
They've outplayed them, so.
They have.
You just have to say to yourself, if you're McEachern, like, we're still in this game at this point. Only thing it's going to take is a couple makes, a couple stops. And someone else other than Cooper at this point is going to have to get involved.
They haven't gotten much from Breed, who has the ball. McElroy hasn't done much. Both of those guys look really good so far in the playoffs. They've been silenced for the most part. Brandon Boston puts his arm up. Alan Breed, little move in the lane, puts it up and in. So Alan Breed gets on the board, and it's just a two-point deficit for the Indians.
And I love when players actually hear us on the sideline. I know he didn't, but he stepped into the challenge, what you just said. Like, someone else has to get involved.
He knew. He knew. Yeah, he knew he hasn't done his part yet.
He stepped up, and he got that possession. That was a big basket for him.
You can't always just rely on your superstar. Speaking of superstars, Boston puts it in, the little roll. 31-27, 30-second timeout called. Let's take a look at what Jesse McMillan wants to do offensively. They want to run. They want to do that five-out motion offense, have the quick hitter set plays to find good matchups. Terrence Hill, former professional player. Have they done that so far?
They have. They've done a great job. Five out, and what that does is it creates a lot of jump shots. It doesn't congest the lane too much, so it allowed for your players like Brandon Boston to get to the hold a little bit easier. So far, I think they've done a great job with executing it. I would like to see a little bit more play from Muhammad on the inside, so maybe more of a four out, one in situation.
Yeah. And you just saw Boston off of the Breed hoop. Good stuff there from the guys. Appreciate it. Brandon Mincy and Chris Hill, great job on the cameras. Doug First producing and directing. Jordan Mills helping out as well. He's Terrence Hill. I'm Justin Hanover with you on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch. Cooper to Okoro. I heard some contact. Isaac will go to the line. We'll have some action next week as well, as we'll be with you for the championships down in Macon. And the winner of this game at 7 o'clock next Saturday will face the winner of tonight's nightcap in Tift County and the defending champions, the Meadow Creek Mustangs.
You know, and don't pay attention. The free throws here are big, but it's more important than that. What he did was Okoro was able to get inside, get the defender off his feet, and get the foul, and that's number two on Muhammad.
It is, and you see the bracket right there. Norcross, McEachern, and then on the bottom, the Blue Devils and the Mustangs. Three-point game, just a one-possession game. Kyle Sturdivant working on McElroy. You don't see either team really going to their bench all that much. You're gonna win or lose with your best tonight. Kyle Sturdivant, Muhammad battling. Okoro throws it out. Here comes Cooper, little one-on-one. Sharif, how great is that body control?
It is, and it goes back to the keys of him being able to get in lane, switch the gears, get the defender on his backside, and once he does, he's going to shield that defender off and go up with the basket. We saw it on that possession.
1 point game. Boston works around the Muhammad screen. Oh, and the double team, the block from Jones, and Okoro again. Here comes Cooper, one on two this time. Sharif, does he get continuation? And McEachern in the lead.
I will reiterate, this guy is phenomenal when it comes to shielding defender, protecting the ball as you go in the lane. Protect it first, shield the defender, and then finish with your left hand.
One on one, one on two. It just doesn't matter when Sharif has it rolling.
It doesn't matter, man. And it surprised me because he stands at 6'1", but he plays like a 6'6", 6'7", type of guy.
Absolutely. Gets 6, 7, 8, 9 rebounds a game sometimes. Pulls the Russell Westbrook. And just like that, McEachern in the lead. A rare lead for the Indians with 3 to go in the third. Boston gets the high screen from Ramsey. Kicks it down low. Daniel Ramsey up and in. Cannon Bishop from Greensboro checking in. Thank you, Cannon. As we are all level, to use a soccer term, at 33. Daniel Ramsey, the Xavier commit. 8 points, 13 rebounds, a couple of blocks in the first round playoff game. It's a big boy.
He is, man. He found himself on a roll, screening, and then you rolling hard. Roll hard, look for the ball, anticipate the ball, and they were able to get him the ball in an and one.
Future Musketeer Coach Thompson calls the full timeout. As this game starts progressing, it starts to get to winning time. And let's take a look again at what we just saw.
Just roll hard. roll with it with the intentions of receiving the ball. You're not going to receive it every time, but every time that you roll, you have to roll with the intent of receiving it. He got the ball. When I speak of Ramsey, got the ball that time and won. Now the lead has changed again, once again. But you need plays like that. You need someone that's going to roll hard to the basket.
How about the pass, though, from Brandon Boston? It was almost – they defended it. They were on the ball, but he showed strength in order to still get it by.
Precision passing. And that's what it was. Precision passing, he had a window, a small window to get it through. He was able to get through. And that doesn't come from luck. That comes from practice, being in the gym, knowing your players, knowing the personnel. That continuity, that was exhibited just there.
What a great afternoon game. It is absolutely packed to the rafters. You just saw the cheerleaders of both teams. I mean, if they fit 5,000 in here, there is 6,000 now because it is standing room all the way around. Coach McMillan probably doesn't know. He's just focused. Oh, Breed, afraid to shoot it there. He passed it up. Alan Breed, that's not like him. As there is a whistle behind the play, but Alan Breed, Andy Muhammad saying, y'all better step it up. He's trying to go to make it for McEachern. That's right, Andy.
No, that's right, man.
With that said, though, you're within one.
Yeah.
You still feel pretty good, but Charles Knight has some other things he's thinking about.
Absolutely. And you're up one, but on that possession, Cooper, as expected, he's telling his player, you have to shoot that. Regardless if you make it, you need to keep
right.
The defense honest, and we need you to take those shots.
Oh, and Jared Jones, the eraser, does it again. This time to Isaac Martin. Sharif Cooper, blocked, but following up. That's the four-star Auburn commit in Isaac Okoro. Just so smart.
Smart, being able to run, and if that would have never occurred if he didn't run the lane. A lot of times players expect for him to make that. He ran the court
exactly.
With his player. Able to get the follow-up.
A lazy player says, oh, Sharif's going to take care of that. We're good. And then there's no rebound. Air ball there.
Give credit to Brandon Boston. Consecutive plays when he's met Cooper at the rim. And it just comes to timing when it comes to the blocks.
Oh, and Sharif loses. And here comes Sturdivant. Jones looking to come back and get the angle. He got a little too much body. And Kyle Sturdivant will be heading to the line. Let's take another look here at Isaac Okoro getting 2 points for his team. Here goes Cooper. He's not even in the screen. Okoro's not in the screen. He's still not. And finally.
And even with McEachern's player, number two,
for McEachern or Norcross?
Norcross.
Right,
two,
Caleb Murphy, yeah.
He had an opportunity of getting that rebound. But it comes to hustle and effort. He lacked off a little bit. And he found Okoro getting the rebound opposed to him.
We have got superstars galore tonight. Each team, I would say, with two bona fide superstars. You're seeing one on the line in Kyle Sturdivant, Brandon Boston as well. Issa Muhammad at times has played like a superstar. And, of course, Sharif Cooper and Isaac Okoro. We saw Jared Jones, who's going to Northwestern. So we've got two, maybe two and a half, three superstars each. And this is a fight to the finish. Isaac will head back to the line. Martin with a foul.
And I tell you, Justin, speaking to some people, they really believe that this game is the finals.
Oh, yeah.
These two teams are heavy hitters, and they wanted to see this in the finals. They got the gift of sitting in the semifinals, but they were a lot of people was expecting these two teams to meet up in the finals. And I tell you, at halftime, and as you mentioned about the crowd, above, I swear, maybe another 1,000 to 2,000
people this is incredible.
Came in the second half.
This is incredible. A minute 28 to go in the third. Deadlocked at 36. Okoro for the lead. No. And Brandon Boston with yet another rebound as
he's bleeding a little bit.
Approaching 20 rebounds. As Okoro with a little bit of blood. So I would assume they'll have to call a timeout here. Let's see. Coach Thompson just burned one a couple of minutes ago.
You know, with it being a timeout, well, I guess he could stay on the court because it was a quick fix. But if they had to choose between taking a timeout or keeping him in the game, I think I would have actually taken him out.
Give him a minute to breathe.
Give him a minute to breathe. Yeah. You have a minute 27 seconds in the quarter, and you're tied right now.
And you see in the background there the legendary Jimmy Dorsey, the athletic director for McEachern, the phenomenal football coach for many years. Jimmy always around this program. We appreciate his hospitality here with the NFHS Network and Facebook the last 3 weeks, giving us some great access to those playoff games as we were able to follow McEachern throughout this run. Coach McMillan saying four with his offense as he's running that four. And Norcross and Meadow Creek, they know each other very well. They've played three times this year. Potential for a fourth as Ramsey took an extra step, did he not?
He did. Definitely took. I think the referee's got it right at that time, took an extra step. Now McEachern is going in on the break.
Yeah, Sharif certainly tried. There he goes. Pulls up from the foul line. No good. Jaden Harris, a 6'3" sophomore, comes in. Boston. Oh, and that's swatted away by both the Coro and Jones. Cooper, one-on-one. And again, he gets the continuation call in effect for the bucket.
Get the continuation. He looks at his hand. Yeah, I got it going right now. I'm feeling good. And it's all about the hero step. It's that slow step to anticipate the defender going past you. Once they go past, come to the other step, whether it's the left or right. And he was able to finish on it and won that possession.
Indians looking for their largest lead, believe it or not, in this one. If he gets that, they go up three. And just like that, McEachern, 39-36. Final possessions here in the third quarter.
And I'm certain McEachern was, they had their poker face on the first half. They do not look like the same team.
No, more energy right now. No. There's pep in their step right now. We're seeing the and ones. We're seeing the aggressiveness going to the hole. Boston, can they hold for one here? Let's see. Ramsey rolls. Oh, a lot of contact. And they're going to call that on Allen Breed. A lot of boos in the building right now.
Yeah. And I strongly believe the boos, as we know, is coming from. They believe it was a charge. If it's not going to be a charge, it was a late whistle. McEachern was almost on their break in transition, and the foul was called.
Let's take another look, Terrence. You play referee.
Say he's set. He comes up at the last minute. I still think he's established. But even if he's not, I think I would have let it go. I think that would have been a great chance of no call. Let them go on break and give the defense some defensive stop.
Well, Ramsey hits both. McEachern up one. Final possession, it appears. Sharif Cooper. And they're going to get a technical foul on Coach Thompson. So suddenly from going in would appear to be the lead after three. Kyle Sturdivant will step to the line.
You know what? That may be that extra hump and up that McEachern needed. To see, sometimes you just need to see your coach involved in having your back. And this might propel them to get a victory in the fourth quarter because they needed to see that. The coach stepping up and defending them on a bad call, seemingly.
Well, we'll see. As you see a great crowd here, all the Blue Devil fans in their togas. Now for the lead, Sturdivant. If you're a McEachern fan, you are not happy about the last 15 or so seconds. Expecting a charge on one end. You were up three. All of a sudden, two free throws go that way. Now, all of a sudden, the technical, and Norcross gets the ball here. Yeah. So you're talking about a 5 or 6 point swing in the last 15 seconds, potentially.
Yeah, Jimmy McEachern, you just want to get a big stop right here because that is a huge swing.
Yeah,
Norcross able to score right here.
They defend really high here on Boston. Long three ball. No good, offensive rebound. Good hustle from Harris, no good. And we end the third quarter with a 1 point lead for Norcross on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch.
Oh, man, I think that was definitely a charge.
Of course it was.
It was a charge.
Not even a question. Yeah. Charge, right? Oh my God.
Yeah, that was not great.
All it doesn't get better than this. Back here in Buford, and it doesn't get better than this. 40-39, Blue Devils on top. Remember, they won 75-55 in the quarters a year ago. McEachern has not lost since that game. We are absolutely filled to the rafters, standing room only. Probably 500 to 1,000 people standing in this building. The number one team in the nation, according to Max Preps. They have the ball trailing by one, final 8 minutes. Sharif Cooper, Isaac Okoro, two of the best players in the nation. Allen Breed, here's Jared Jones. They work it around.
You know, Jones, he's been hesitant to take that three in the second half, and I'm not sure why. He knocked three of them down in the first half. He should feel confident on taking those shots right now.
And Jones will get called for the foul. What a good aggressive move by Sturdivant.
He was just able to get himself in front of the defender, and Jones comes up with the foul. But a great push for Sturdivant.
Yeah, that was a good job, but Sharif Cooper caught in the air going baseline. So Sturdivant to the line. He's really been aggressive. I mean, he's been making a living at the line here.
He has. And I don't think he gets a lot of credit. He's one of the guys that's going to get everyone in position. I've seen him out there being a facilitator. He's been able to score. He's been able to push the ball. Gives you a little bit of everything, and I don't think he gets enough credit being on the team with the likes of a Brandon Boston.
Right, Boston's sort of the superstar, but Sturdivant does the dirty work.
Yeah.
He does a lot of the stuff to get the ball in the right places, the ball movement, the off-the-ball stuff. 3-point lead now for the Blue Devils. We'll have to go back and remember that block call because that could wind up being a turning point. Kyle Sturdivant with 13. Brandon Boston still just 11. Cooper with 14 and Okoro with 10. Appreciate that. Will Hammock of the Gwinnett Daily Post doing some great work and double duty and helping us out a little bit. John Stewart, he's rooting hard here for his Indians. Renee still involved. Appreciate it, Renee. Jordan Divins, what a game. Absolutely. Norcross trying to get in there. And they have been every bit as good as McEachern tonight, if not better. Boston way downtown. Okoro and a good hustle foul. You can't blame a foul in that scenario as they'll get Brandon Boston really just trying to get the ball.
He is. And I think if he had a chance to take that back, he would have maybe taken a step or two closer to the line because he was in range, but maybe stepping in a little bit closer, you can get that rhythm. You want to see it go down just a couple times before you step back up.
And the three is up and in.
And they come out to man-to-man. They don't look tired right now. They're going to man-to-man defense. I know you feed off the crowd.
Oh,
he comes up with a turnover, and they're going to push the ball. No question about it.
Cooper again caught in the air. By the way, Allen Breed there finally knocking down a three. Maybe that's a good sign here that they can get that outside game going with somebody other than Jared Jones. Speaking about an outside game, how about Mr. Cooper giving them a three-point lead again?
Yes, sir, man. And in the entire time, you saw.
Oh, and right back at you says Mr. Sturdivant. Here we go. I think this game's going to pick up. Okoro defended very well by Eskridge. Boston. Oh, they're going to call. Yep.
Oh, I think that was a bad call.
He tried to go behind his back. I just think he lost possession. I didn't really think he double dribbled per se.
And I think it actually hit the
back
foot,
of his knee, right?
The foot of the defender, and he picked it up. I didn't see a double dribble. I think it just hit the back of the defender.
Let's take another look at Sharif Cooper. His heel, I think, was almost out of bounds.
Yeah,
did you see that?
I did.
He was an inch from out of bounds, and then Sturdivant going the other way.
And he refused to come out that corner. He called for the ball for at least 10 seconds. He received it finally because he knows, that's my spot. I'm not leaving here. They finally got it to him. And what do you have? You got that three.
Sharif Cooper started slow, it felt like. 4 points at the half.
Yeah.
He's up to 17. I mean, it's a sign of a superstar.
It is.
And he's about to possibly take over this game. You see him right there in the huddle.
And with Norcross being able to send, and they like to run different defenses, you're going to have to start sending a different look. It's only 5 minutes left in the game. Start sending different looks at Cooper to because right now he hasn't found his swag. He's found his little his bounce. So seeing a little different crowd looks at him to see if he can get mixed up.
Look at that crowd shot. Oh, boy. There is not a seat that is empty in a Buford City arena that is basically a college arena. Cooper again. Oh, Sharif Cooper. Here we go. This is what we expected from the five-star. The future possibly Auburn Tiger, Kentucky Wildcat. Sturdivant trying to go tit for tat, and he'll go back to the line showing that aggressive nature.
Yeah. I'd like to see this, you know, two guys going at each other. But what makes him so effective is he doesn't have to get off the ground a lot on his jump.
How quick was that, though?
It's quick. He doesn't utilize his legs too much. So now it's harder for the defender to gauge when he's going to shoot that, because he doesn't have too much bounce and lift on the shot.
And that just rimmed out. 4-point McEachern lead. Very big next 2 minutes. Norcross cannot let this grow to 8 or 9 or 10. Still a one possession game.
Sturdivant has to be very careful at the free throw line. Consecutive plays, he's leaned forward before the ball hit the rim. And I know they're stickler when it comes to in high school with the shooter going past the line before he touches the rim.
Dueling twos. Here's Sharif working on Murphy. A tough assignment for Caleb Murphy, that's for sure. Team seventh, so did they say seven or second?
Seventh.
Yep. So we will see a lot of free throws right now for the Indians, potentially. In a good spot, Coach Thompson called a good timeout earlier.
Yeah.
Give him credit. He's called a bunch of timeouts. He's managed this game very well.
He has.
Never let it get away from them at all.
No. And some people question, are coaches relevant these days? The answer is yes, because you need a coach that's going to call the timeout at the right time. You will need a coach to facilitate your players. And tonight, the coaching that battles between both coaches, I think it's been great.
And they'll use another one. Interesting. Let me ask you this.
Yep.
And again, he's Terrence Hill, former Kennesaw State National Champion. I'm Justin Hanover here on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch. Two more games to go after this one. Ladies are up next, then the men again. You get momentum.
Right.
You go up five. What is the rationale now for Coach Thompson's timeouts? I understood earlier. Now what is he thinking?
It's more about just getting your players in and calming them down. You don't want your players to come out. You're up by five. You don't want to have any forced plays. You don't want to have any ill-advised shot. Every possession now that we're up 5 points, let's make it count. If we can't get the shot that we need, let's reset it. We're up. Make them come out a little bit further. That's our advantage if they come out further, because now since we have Cooper, a guy that can drive, it only creates a bigger lane for him to penetrate.
So basically he's reminding his team, we're in control now.
Absolutely.
The clock is now our ally. Be smart.
Yep.
Let's not have any empty possessions.
No, you can't afford an empty possession. I know you're up, but you can't afford an empty possession. You know why? You have Brandon Boston on the other end. You have other Muhammad. You have a great team on the other end.
Who's been quiet, by the way. Issa Muhammad, really good in that first half. 9 points, 5 rebounds. We haven't mentioned his name, basically, in the second half. Where is he gone?
That's the thing. You can't fade away from games. You can't fade, especially in big games like this. You have to stay relevant. You can't fade. Even in this, he was aggressive on that possession before, but now he's more passive.
Sturdivant puts it up and in. The foul on Jared Jones. And Kyle Sturdivant's aggressive play continues to pay off in spades.
I'll piggyback off what I just said. This is why you don't want to have empty possessions, and you want a good defensive stop, because you have guys that can score the ball for Norcross.
And a 2-point game. Kyle Sturdivant, how good has he been?
Yeah.
Future USC Trojan. You'll be happy out west to have Kyle, that's for sure. Remember USC with Baby Jordan, Harold Miner back in the day? They've had some good teams.
Miami Heat, yeah, man.
Yep.
This is what I suspected. I expected the teacher to come out, hold the ball. No shot clock in high school basketball.
Isaac Martin now defending MVP. Maybe a little bit too early, but let's hear. You join the conversation. Who can be your pick for MVP? As of right now, who knows? It's anybody's ball game. Kyle Sturdivant certainly has got a great case. Sharif Cooper, But we've got 4 minutes and 25 seconds that will determine that, if not longer.
Yep. And you know, the highlighted player for Norcross still is, it's Boston. But I tell you, man, he has come out and he's played a great game, but he's been able to facilitate and get his teammates involved.
No points in the second half for Brandon. Jared Jones, by the way, getting a blow on the bench. Here's Breed with an aggressive move. He draws the foul on Double B.
That's exactly what they want.
That's his third.
They're going to spread, and they, like you said, a third foul.
Yep, and they're at the foul line now.
Yep.
So if you get a foul called on them, Alan Breed, a good foul shooter, could be a couple of free points here from the charity stripe.
I tell you, Justin, it's frowned upon in the basketball circuit for someone, a team, to hold the ball in high school. I'm not against it, especially in the semifinals. If you're up, you can hold the ball, milk the clock, force them to foul, go to the free throw line and do what you're supposed to and knock your free throws down. But I'm not opposed to it.
Now, I don't think they're not going to shoot, but I do think they're not going to make a point of it, Coach Thompson, not to shoot a bad shot.
Of course.
We're in the driver's seat, and we're now up four.
There's no need to shoot a bad shot. Get the shot that you want. Not a good shot, but a great shot.
Under the midway mark here of the fourth quarter, Boston takes it from Sturdivant back to Kyle. He's going to drive the lane over Isaac and up and in. And the Kyle Sturdivant show continues. He's a man on a mission right now.
He is, man. And I tell you, you love this matchup. You love to see this. He is not letting his team go away without a fight.
Cooper, again, can he do that? Nope. And there's finally Issa Muhammad. Sturdivant calling his own number. Foul line jumper, no good.
You like that shot from Sturdivant. You like it. He was able to get into the middle. Wide open shot. But this right here is the floater. Get it over the defender, lift it up, splash.
Oh, by the way, that's over maybe the best defender in the country also. Offensive foul called on Muhammad. And because the best defender in the country got the position and took it. Third foul, team ninth. Obviously, you don't shoot on the offensive foul like that. We'll take another look. Muhammad. Oh, boy.
Right in the chest.
Yeah. East is a big boy, too. That's taking one for the team.
And go back in a couple plays. Every possession counts in basketball, but close, especially games like this.
They count more now.
They count more now. But with a team that has the pedigree that McEachern has, gotta finish every single play. And now you find yourself down by two points with 3 minutes left.
So they're gonna spread them out. You see what McEachern's doing, spreading everybody out, and they call a travel on Okoro. I saw you made the travel sign. You saw it from across the court.
Definitely did. I thought he was gonna stop after that second step, but he took one extra step going back. And thought the referees were not gonna call it, but it was a late whistle.
Once again, the winner here will play 7 o'clock next Saturday in Macon against the winner of the later game. There's the defensive player, Nakoro, and Muhammad will pick up that foul. The winner of tonight's game, Meadow Creek and Tiff County. By the way, congratulations earlier to Westlake, Cam Newton's old school. As they race past North Forsyth, they punch their ticket to play either Collins Hill or Cherokee, which will be the next game right here on the NFHS Network.
And I tell you, with all these peoples in this gym,
can we get a shot of this, though?
Absolutely.
Of Sharif Cooper, guys? Can we get a shot? Sharif Cooper, you talk about a guy that does it all. Can we get Sharif here wiping the floor?
Wiping the floor.
This may be the only thing he has not done this year.
Look at
that. The crowd loves it right here.
We greater than me.
Yep.
He's a team
up
player,
now Okoro, he passes it off to Isaac. Oh, this is great.
That's love, man.
This is great.
But you know what? That's on their end of the court. And they say, you know what? There's no way we're going to slip and make a mistake right here. Let us clean it up.
That's some good stuff. High school basketball in the state of Georgia. You think LeBron would ever do that or any of the superstars in that league?
No. High school, yes.
Good stuff. Sharif Cooper and Isaac Okoro up by two, 2:50 to go. He's Terrence Hill. I'm Justin Hanover. You're watching this on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch. And we said it earlier, nobody's running away. No 20-point wins today. This is coming down to possibly the last possession.
It is. If it's not the last shot, I think it's going to be maybe two possessions before maybe a turnover, a charge, or something that's going to result in the win. But speaking for these players, I've been in this situation where I went to the semifinals in Alabama, Fort Payne High School, and we're in the semifinals. And with all these people in this gym, only thing that you focus in and zone in right now are the people on the court and making the right play next. So right now, these players on the court, they see no one else in the gym. They feel as if it's them and the other team.
Let us know your vote for MVP. Jared Jones back in the game. Nobody on the foul line there. Interesting. I mean, you've got Jared Jones. You've got guys that can get offensive boards, but yet they played a conservative strategy.
You don't want to risk getting a foul since they're in the bonus of trying to get the rebound and sending them to the free throw line for easy basket.
Jumper good. The future Musketeer and Daniel Ramsey with a big bucket right there. Dooley Hendricks says Coop, and certainly I'd say Sharif Cooper's in the driver's seat if McEachern can hang on here. Jalen Simmons agrees. Trey Ross agrees. Consensus right now, LeVar. What about the other way, though? Keep it up, Sharif says. Sharif, I mean, certainly Kyle Sturdivant if Norcross comes back. Brandon Boston's a great player, but it's been all Kyle Sturdivant down the stretch.
Yeah.
We take another look here of KS.
And Ramsey with wide open, found himself wide open.
But you had to double team Sturdivant. See, that's the thing. You're so good tonight, Kyle Sturdivant, right? Defensively, you've got to respect that, and it opens it up then for Daniel Ramsey.
He created the double team from the previous plays as he's made, and now it's opened up for Ramsey. But I'll give you another scenario. If Muhammad would have been in the game instead of Ramsey, I think he would have been hesitant to take that shot.
Yeah.
Great coaching change for Norcross to put Ramsey in that game because he had the confidence to take that shot and it paid off.
Confidence is an amazing thing, is it not?
Yeah, it is.
Issa Muhammad in the first half was energetic, was jumping through the roof, and it's just been a complete change here in the second half.
Yep. And right now you don't see Ramsey in the game. You don't see Muhammad. They're going to the smaller lineup to see if they can get some steals, get in the passing lane.
Defensively.
They need a defensive stop.
Lewis Williams in, number 10, the 6'5" senior. We'll see Jaden Harris. A couple of guys that do not get a ton of minutes but are athletic and can get the ball back. So maybe a little offense-defense type plan here from Norcross. Three ball, no good. Okoro has it ripped out of his hand. Very well done there by Murphy. Boston takes an extra step, puts it up, no good. And cleared by Okoro. Boston, though, with a good job. Who's got the arrow? And it'll stay right here. A little fist pump from Double B.
That just shows you don't give up on the play. Boston came down, missed a shot from great defense from Jones. I'm not going to give up on the play. Let me see if I can get this defense stopped. He ended up coming with a jump ball and gave them possession back.
We wind down to 2 minutes remaining. Indians up two. Double bonus for everybody. Sturdivant's been brilliant tonight. Oh, he stepped out of bounds. Lost. He had to look back to find a teammate. He got caught a little bit. And it's good defending, though, because you know as well as anybody, you use that sideline as another defender.
Oh, people talk about the crowd being the sixth man in the gym. No, the sideline and the baseline, that's the sixth man on the court. Rely on that sideline in the baseline.
Now do you look even a shoot? Okoro does, and he missed. But Sharif with a big offensive rebound. And very heads-up play. These guys are so smart. They don't get enough credit how smart they are, these players.
Yeah, no, they do. Sharif, that's basketball IQ.
Yep.
To grab the rebound, first of all, not to go up with it. But secondly, to be canny enough to call the timeout. You see Coach Thompson, as soon as they called a timeout, he came out with his hands up like, guys, what are you guys doing? Two plays we came down and took a shot. We don't need to take a shot. We don't need urgency at this point.
Now, McEachern has not had a fight like this since a long time. They win games and they win them big. How are they going to do in crunch time when each possession at the end of the fourth quarter matters? They're not used to having a stall or use the clock as their ally. This is big right now.
It is. New terrain for them. And I do believe, though, they have the mental fortitude to try to close this game. If they can keep the ball and get good shots, I think they have the fortitude to close the game like they're supposed to.
Obviously, no shot clock. Time is their ally. Up two. Sharif, You don't want to be too hesitant, though. You don't want to pass up a totally open look. They're not even looking to shoot at this moment. A minute 20. They've just bled off about 25 seconds since the inbounds.
And under 1 minute, Norcross, you're going to have to try to foul. First of all, go for the steal, but you're going to have to foul under 1 minute.
Alley-oop! Oh, and it's missed by Jones. They're going to call a tie-up, and it's McEachern ball. You saw exactly what developed there, and Cooper went up, but Jones could not put it down. A minute six remaining. Tricky little play. Lewis Williams tried to come from that backside.
That's what you're going to need. You're going to need that effort, but if they're getting...
But you don't have to foul now, right?
No,
plenty of time left.
You don't need to foul. You need to try to get the steal.
Right. Little cat and mouse game.
Absolutely. And look for traps on the side.
And Sharif gets hit in the eye there by Caleb Murphy. He'll go to the line for a pair with 58.5.
Not a bad foul, but I will say, I personally, if I was a coach, I would start fouling around this point. Because once you start fouling, you're going to have to force them to make free throws. I'm speaking of McEachern. If they're able to miss some free throws, you have more opportunities to come down and tie the game up. So at some point, you're going to start fouling so you can create more opportunities for yourself.
You're only down two, though. If you're down five or six, I get it. You have to extend the game. I think they had a little bit of more time. You see Coach McMillan there discussing a strategy with the assistants. I think they could have played it out a little longer, but I think Sharif made an aggressive move, and you had no choice.
See, but with two, being down two in high school without a shot clock, it's like being down 7 points with a shot clock. It's a sense of urgency. You have to look to foul because 2 points is more than two wins without any shot clock.
Eskridge comes in for Martin. Sharif Cooper misses the front end. It's going to be a one-possession game either way here with under a minute to play. Gets the roll. Three-point game. Certainly you do not need a three.
No.
Get a good possession, I would think. Sturdivant, been aggressive all afternoon, working on Cooper. Similar size. Sturdivant off the window and in. Kyle Sturdivant absolutely putting on a clinic. All the talk coming in was Okoro and Cooper and Boston. Kyle Sturdivant says, I'm not a fourth wheel.
Don't forget about me. I can play as well. And what I believe in the timeout for Coach McMillan at this point, find yourself down by 1 point. And right now, since you're only down by one, no, you don't necessarily have to foul. But try to get some steals. Get in the passing lanes. And the McEachern, they're prone to go to the side. That's when you can actually trap. Try to get some traps. See if they can lob the ball, and then you can steal it. But once it gets down to 20 seconds, look to foul.
Kyle Sturdivant, 21 of his 23 points in the second half. Thank you, Will Hammack of the Gwinnett Daily Post. 21 second-half points. Again, they only play eight-minute quarters. This is not the NBA. This is not even college. So we're talking about, what, in the last 15 minutes against the number one team in the entire nation, he has scored 21 points by himself.
Translation, his plus-minus right now, out the roof.
Translation, should USC be happy or should they be nervous because maybe another door is opened up?
Right.
We'll let that, we'll keep that to wherever that goes then. 48.7, a lot of strategy. It's a chess match right now. At what point do you have to foul?
I say under 20 seconds.
Okay, so you go 20 seconds for a steal here.
Yep.
Alan Breed, guarded by Boston. And it looks like they want to foul Okoro, and that's what they did. They wanted Martin to foul Isaac Okoro.
So let me add to what I said with the 20 seconds, because I see this now. I would have went 20 seconds, but if the ball would have ended up in the right person's
hand. Right, exactly. No, that's understood. Absolutely understood. And Okoro, not a bad foul shooter at all. It's just you got to pick somebody, I guess.
It just sucks when you have a team of players that can shoot free throws.
He knocks it down. Still, though, will only be a one-possession game. Big one right here with 33.9. You expect Kyle Sturdivant to continue to have a lot of the possession and at least facilitate. That's up and good. Two free throws, money. 33.9. Here comes Sturdivant. Defense is all man-to-man right now. Gets the high screen, Sturdivant. Jones rotates over well. Not giving up the three. Boston, oh, and that's a turnover, no! Deflected off of, I believe, Cooper with 21.4 to go.
And if this was the NBA, the referee would wave at us, tell us they want to come to the replay, not the NBA.
You can tell from the body language, it was a good call. Nobody really complaining. So well done by this crew. John Ewald, Doug Richardson, and Marvin Harris. Been very good all game. 21.4 remaining, 57-54 Indians. And a timeout called as Sturdivant just could not get it in. That McEachern defense, not as press happy today as we've seen. They've come back, but they've done a good job in that half court defensive set.
They have. And at this point right now for Norcross, you still don't need a three. It's not important right now for you to take a three. Let's get a quick shot of two. Preferably, let's get a layup, okay? An easy layup, come
high
down.
High percentage, sure.
High percentage. And then foul, send it to the free throw line. Let's hope that they miss one, hopefully two. But you don't need a three.
How about this statistic, by the way? January 19th, so when was that? You're talking a month and a half ago? Right. Was the last single-digit game that McEachern was involved in as a final.
Yeah, how do you prepare for that?
Even if the coach has you prepared, you're mentally tuning out. Come on, coach, we're the best. You know, we read out press clippings. We're number one in the nation. We don't have to grunt it out here on the floor. But you know what they have? McEachern's done a nice job here closing this out. Let's see if they can do it for the final 21 seconds.
Yeah. And the most important play for Norcross right now is not scoring the basketball. It's actually just getting the ball inbound.
Yeah, tough corner to get it in front.
It is.
You got that sideline to Sturdivant's right.
Absolutely.
First things first, get it inbounds, and they do a good job to Isaac Martin. High screen being set by Muhammad Sturdivant, 15 seconds remaining. Sturdivant, you don't want to foul for a three-point play. Good look from three, and he knocks it down. Oh, and the crowd erupts. Caleb Murphy tied at 57. For the win!
This
destiny.
Is what they come for.
Destiny! We are going overtime, tied at 57. Caleb Murphy!
Young man stepped up to the challenge. Get the defender off his feet. Step up, knock the shot down. Bring the crowd off the feet.
May I steal a Ludens from you, my friend?
Absolutely.
I think the voice was just lost. Oh, boy, of all the stars in this one, Caleb Murphy. Watch him step up, though. They double on Sturdivant, who he finds the right man, collects his thought, and knocks it down. Ice water in those veins, Caleb Murphy. And then on the other end, I thought maybe Sharif was going to be special, and he just couldn't come away with it.
Yeah, that's poise. It shows poise. For Murphy was able to step up and knock that down. He went through all of his technique, went up, came straight back down on the three, knocked it down, sends the game into overtime. What else do you need if you come to the game? This is what you pay for. This is what you want to see.
Let me ask you this. You see all the rotating bodies on Norcross.
Yeah.
They have used many more numbers, basically just the starting five for McEachern. How much of a role does that play in this four-minute overtime?
It doesn't play a role at all at this point. The importance of the game and what's on the line will outweigh you being tired. Fatigue is not a measure or even matters right now. You know what's important right now. It's a big.
So the adrenaline is so much there that it's not about fatigue right now.
Adrenaline, the crowd.
Murphy confident. And that's swatted back. If McEachern wants to go down in the annals of one of the greatest teams ever, they're going to have to fight and claw right now. Cooper misses.
Even in the overtime, referees are letting these guys play. They're not calling no touch fouls. They're letting them play. That's what you want to see because you don't want it to come down to the referee being involved in the game and they making the deciding factor. Let the players play, and I think they've done a great job here tonight.
Here's Muhammad, who's been quiet since that great first half. Brandon Boston. Boston yet to score here since the first half. It's been all about Kyle Sturdivant. It was 24-21 Norcross at the half, 40-39 after three. Breed fakes the three, drives baseline. Kicks it back out to Okoro. Now Sharif, we dip under 3 minutes. Nobody's yet to score in this extra session. Okoro swings it across. Quinton McElroy, so good in that last game, has done little. Made 1-3. Cooper, little head fake. Wide open Jones for his 4-3. No good, no! Oh, and the foul on Brandon Boston. That'll be his fourth as Okoro fought for that rebound. And Boston shaken up.
Tough rebound. Came down on his back. I think might hit his head a little bit. Both guys, they know what it means to grab that rebound.
Really an unlucky foul in Boston. It's just the way everybody fell. His momentum went on top. And Boston hobbling a bit here. You don't see him on your screen, but he's down to a couple of knees.
Yep.
He's certainly a little bit shaken up.
And I think it might be the ankle because he just untied his shoe.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if that's the best idea, if it's the ankle. You want to keep that tight as possible.
Yeah, limping a little bit. Maybe that's why he did that, though. Missed the front end here. Tied at 57, 2:38 to go in overtime. Terrence Hill, Justin Hanover in what may be the game of the year in this country right now. It's the number one team in America against the team that beat them by 20 a year ago in overtime for a berth in the championship. And Isaac Okoro with an empty trip. Now 2.5 to go. The brilliant Kyle Sturdivant working on the five-star in Sharif Cooper. High screen set, goes around the other way.
We talked about this over the break, and I asked you, I said, do you think this, what is this rank, what is this game rank in the past 5 years? And you said this may be the best game in the country.
How does it get better than this?
It doesn't, man.
The number one team in overtime against the team that beat him last year. Look at the confidence exuded right now by Caleb Murphy. You hit one shot, and you feel like you're the man. Look at Murphy. Breathes, clapping his hands. Under two to go. Oh, this is Georgia high school sports, baby. Oh, and he gives it away. Cooper on Sturdivant, weaving around, 3-on-1. Sharif off the window, no good. Okoro, he'll head back to the line. Cooper just sort of mangled it a little bit instead of, he knew what he wanted to do. The ball wasn't cooperating with him.
Just a little bit too much dancing for Murphy for me. Too much dancing. If you're going to dance out there, dance a couple times, put him in a spin, and then get past him. Too much dancing and holding the ball.
I want to know from everybody out there, as you're watching this on the NFHS Network and Facebook Watch, where does this game rate in your history? Is this, am I crazy to say one of the greatest games you've ever seen, Terrence? I mean, you've seen a lot of college, you've played in a lot of games, so certainly it's not your favorite probably, but this is going to be up there.
But as a spectator, I want to say this is top three in games that I've seen, collegiate level and high school.
What do you guys think on Facebook? Okoro makes them both after missing both. So a minute 41 remaining, 59-57. Indians trying to close this out for a second time. Sturdivant's been a little quieter of late. Ooh, a little miscommunication almost there, but ball gets back in Kyle's hands. High screen, Muhammad. Sturdivant steps up. No good. Jones clears, gets it to Okoro. And we're back in the situation. History repeating itself. Deja vu all over again. Use whatever phrase you want. And a little overzealous play by Eskridge will lead to a couple of more free throws from Okoro.
Okoro's been able to go to the free throw line and knock these down. So, you know, I'm not a fan of that foul. I know you're in the pass.
He got caught in the middle, right?
He got caught in the middle.
He thought when he made the move he could intercept it, and then he was caught.
That's one of those things where you stay back and let us defend and see if we can get a steal. We don't need to send him to the free throw line shooting two, especially a guy that's proven that he can go to the free throw line and knock
down. There's no nerves right now from Okoro. If he had nerves, they'd be long gone. It's probably his 14th, 15th free throw attempt, I would assume.
And I thought it was going to be the announcer jinx. When we talk about the free throw, the player get up there and they miss it. But Okoro is smooth right now.
There's Coach McMillan telling his team, let's go. Rotating his hand around saying, let's go. Go at him. Be aggressive. He either makes them both or he misses them both. Two possession game, 4-point lead. And the crowd getting on their feet here with a minute 8 remaining. You've seen Kyle Sturdivant slow down a little bit. You spoke about adrenaline, but he put this team on his back. Is there potentially a little bit of fatigue in those legs?
So now, when you find yourself down by four, that fatigue starts to set in. Start of the overtime, you're tied up, there's no such thing as fatigue. But find yourself down by four, now you're starting to feel your legs a little bit heavy, and now it's a little hard to get past the defenders. But who's going to step up and make some baskets for Norcross? Sturdivant has been that guy, been that catalyst that can take them, but someone else needs to step up at this point.
Blue Devils, five-time state championships since 2005-2006, one of the best programs in this nation. You see Coach McMillan, Kyle Sturdivant, and then you've got McEachern, who wants to get to that point. They have not won a championship, but again, the starting five is 55-3 the last 2 years. If they cannot get it done in this last minute and eight and then the championship, it's almost all for naught. Okoro and Cooper combined 84-4 together wearing this jersey.
Yep.
They have to close this out and win next Saturday in order for it to truly be a successful season.
100% agree with you, especially with this caliber team. This is a team that can win it, not only in the state, nationally ranked. So you need to win here and then go into the state. You got to win that. If not, the season's for nothing. There's no moral victory when it comes to the keeper.
Sturdivant will head to the line, an aggressive move. We take another look. Did he take an extra step? Well, we'll give the benefit of the doubt.
I think Muhammad stuck his leg out before he took. He did take an extra step. I think Muhammad stuck his leg out and had the foul before then. But I'm sorry, not Muhammad. But
Jared Jones. And I believe he may have just fouled out. Well, let's see. Jared Jones headed to the bench. I did not hear what they called officially. Oh, that's a big miss for Sturdivant.
It goes back to what I mentioned before. Later on in the game, when you get closer, the crowd's involved. That free throw that you had before when you were leaning forward just a little bit, now you're leaning forward a lot. And on that last possession, he's leaning forward, so that takes away your technique from the free throw line.
Now, how do you only have one on that offensive rebounding position? You're down four. You've got to make things happen. Why was Isaac Martin the only guy that could get a rebound there?
I can't explain that. Maybe it's when Jones went out, no one wanted to replace him or no one noticed to replace him. But you need two guys.
Well, no, I'm saying the other way. As what do we have here? Murphy's called for a foul. Jared Bush will look to get in the score column. Bush was very good with, I believe, 12 points in the first round game against East Coweta. I just don't understand why Norcross didn't have more than one on the line. You have to push this pace right now.
Yeah, and I misspoke. I mean Norcross.
Right,
Norcross should definitely had some guys on the line. Can't just be one guy. You need two guys on there because anything can happen.
Right, you've got to push the pace. There's nothing to lose right now.
Long rebound, anything. Fighting for the rebound, you come up with it, but you need two guys in there fighting for that rebound.
Big first free throw by Bush, 5-point lead. Looking for a half a dozen. Biggest lead of the day for the McEachern Indians. 53.6 remaining. They look to remain undefeated and improve to 31-0. Sturdivant, Norcross, need to make a little magic right now. Murphy did it moments ago. Three ball, good! Isaac Martin. The mid-major recruit, the 6'5" senior coming through.
Big shot.
We saw Murphy do it. Now Martin, the guys that aren't your superstars, hitting the big threes.
The left.
That may have been the game right there had he missed.
Yeah.
And Murphy with a good fake step back. The three, they tried to close him out with Cooper. Not in time. Oh, baby.
I want to say that was even a perfect closeout from Cooper. He came and contested the shot. He didn't go into the body of the offensive player. He went on the side. It was just a better offensive play for the Norcross.
He's just not as tall as Zion Williamson, who last week when he did that in the closeout. If Sharif had another 7 or 8 inches, it may have been history right there.
Big shot.
Huge shot. three-point game, 39.8. Now again, I think you have to apply absolute full court pressure. If they get it in, you don't have to foul right away. You need to go for the steal. Is that correct logic?
Yep.
But you do have to foul maybe within about 10, 15 seconds because you're down three. You're not down one or two now.
So now that the ball is, they have to go full court. McEachern has to go full court. Try to get some traps and try to get a violation. And if not, if they get it past half court, look to trap, steal. But if not, don't let too much time run off the clock before you foul.
And Cooper uses that speed and quickness and gets past everybody. Sharif Cooper gets it blocked away. Lewis Williams, another one of the guys that don't play a ton with a big play.
You know, sometimes you see the experience come into play. At that time, you were like for Cooper to pull that out. I know you had the lane wide open, but pull that out and let them get fouled and go to the free throw line.
Sharif almost trying to act his way into a foul using his head bob. Did not get the call at first and almost lost control.
Yeah, and trust me, that head bob and flopping, it works these days. A little different when I play, but it definitely works.
Old
but
school.
You know what? The referee
did a nice job. No,
they
right.
Did.
They didn't give into it at first until I think it was real contact. So here's Cooper looking to make it a two-possession game. Cool, calm, and collected.
Yep. A junior.
Yeah, I'd say he may be the favorite to win National Player of the Year next year. Probably won't get it this year, but there's a reason why Coach Calipari was sitting in his gym 5 days ago. 25 seconds to go, five-point game, 65-60. Caleb Murphy hit a big three earlier, loses it. Sharif Cooper's going to just take his time. Sturdivant fouls him, and I think two made foul shots right here will lights out for Norcross.
Give credit to him on that possession, the basketball IQ. I spoke up the best possession before where he went in and got blocked. That time, he still had a wide open lane. Instead of going in, he pulled it out and allowed them to foul him. And that's more important than getting that layup at this point.
5-point ball game, 14.4. I would say this next shot is for all the marbles.
Don't get the dagger.
Champions need to overcome adversity at some point along the way. This could be that for McEachern. Sturdivant needs to take a three. They need to kick it out. That's not going to be enough.
No.
The clock will continue to go. No foul. Cooper throws it off the scoreboard. And McEachern, they earned it. They maybe didn't play their best Terrence Hill, but they earned this victory and a berth in the final.
They did. And I told you, not going back to it, it's the poker face. First half, they seemed exhausted. Came out in the second half, and they put on a show for the crowd. Cooper, Okoro, they put on a show for the crowd, and they deserve this victory tonight.
A great effort from Norcross, who won a year ago. You knew McEachern at least closed that gap. They weren't going to lose by 20. Norcross hit him hard, but the Indians could not. The thing is, they were losing, but it never became more than three or four.
And that was when Cooper wasn't only had
right,
4 points.
Right.
He went down so much, and that's what I spoke about. That was a gift and a curse. You're only down by 5 points when Cooper wasn't scoring.
Champions need adversity. They had it here. They came through. You see the hugs. They'll advance 7 o'clock next week in Macon. The road to state. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Appreciate Doug First producing and directing. Jordan Mills on the graphics. Brandon Vinci and Chris Hill. Great stuff on those cameras. He's Terrence Hill. I'm Justin Hanover. One of the greatest games I have ever seen. Congratulations to McEachern as they survive and advance. This has been a production of Play On Sports and a presentation of the NFHS Network.